So today's topic key points are to identify the neuroimaging findings and come to a differential diagnosis based on the bilateral basal ganglia and thalamic lesions, predominantly which are hyperintense on T2 and other imaging modalities. So most importantly, we need to narrow down the differentials, and there should be a diagnostic algorithm with a structured report. Very important. Most of the times, residents, I keep seeing them, they're just in front of the workstation. You have to move out of your workstation, see the patient, take the history, check for the other serum markers, any blood lesions which is relevant to your study, and then start reporting. Don't directly just start seeing the images and start reporting. So most importantly, before I start discussing about the pathologies, just want to tell a few words about the function of basal ganglia and thalamus. Most of the time when we are studying, we hardly forget the function of the important structures. Whichever part you are studying, especially please go through the function. So main function of basal ganglia is the body movement control. And the main function of thalamus is also called as the inner chamber or the meeting place. So it mainly helps in the relay of sensation, the spatial sense, regulation of consciousness, sleep and alertness. In case you are not sleeping and you are not completely restless, you could be definitely able to see the images. So the components of a basal ganglia mainly include the caudate nucleus, the putamen and the globus pallidus. Briefly about the vascular supply, which you need to know, because you will be seeing cases where there are thrombosis or there is an infarct, you need to know which vessel is thrombus. So the briefly of the basal ganglia is mainly supplied by the proximal M1 segment of the MCA and other branches from the infrahead of the caudate or the ACA. The thalamus has predominantly by the posterior circulation. So these are the vessels which you can go through. So I'll start with the cases. Fine. So before cases, imaging protocol, very important. I request the residents sit in front of the console when the technician is doing the scanning protocol. The technician will ask you, I'm seeing some abnormality in T1 or T2. What are the further investigation or the further sequences you want me to do? They'll ask. So if you have a good knowledge about the sequences, definitely you'll be guiding the technician what are the other sequences you're supposed to do once you're seeing any abnormality, like hyperintensity of the basal ganglia or thalami on a T2 or T1. But always recommend to do a coronal flare sequence, followed by, if you're suspecting hyperintensity, do a DWA corresponding ADC mapping and susceptibly weighted image. And other imaging based on the pathology and the history, you can do the 3D TOF or 2D TOF and post contrast when you are suspecting any malignant lesion. Fine. There are like around 20 pathologies which commonly affect the basal ganglia and the thalamus, which is quite difficult to discuss in this short moment of time. So we'll be discussing on 7 cases which are most common in India, and they're like, you will have these cases in your practical exam, and the exam will expect you to answer correctly without differential for these cases. So this is a case 1, there is a 4-year-old female, complaints of fever and altered sensorium. So I have given the images over here, as you can see, there is bilateral thalami and the basal ganglia and the brainstem, you are seeing a T2 hyperintensity. The GRA further imaging was done, there was no hypointensity. And then in corresponding diffusion weighted imaging in the ADC, it shows a restricted diffusion. First thing is, when you sit in front of the console, you are seeing bilateral basal ganglia and the thalamic and the base, including the brainstem hyperintensity. Always ask the patient history, whether it is an adult male or an adult young female, what was the history of fever, from how many days she had altered sensorium, was there any history of any drug intake, was there any other history of trauma, all this matter long. Then we are going to start evaluating. Once you are seeing hyperintensity in the basal ganglia, thalamic, brainstem, you need to narrow down your differentials and, if possible, come to a near conclusion diagnosis based on MR image. Just don't describe bilateral symmetrical basal ganglia and thalamic hyperintensity noted as a clinical correlation. Even the clinician can make what is a hyperintensity. As a resident, try to evaluate the patient, take yourself history, evaluate, then come to the imaging and then to a near possible diagnosis. So lab investigation showed there was a serology positive for Japanese encephalitis. This was a classical case of a Japanese encephalitis. Next, case number 2, we have a 21-year-old postpartum, complaints of headache, vomiting and seizures. These are the classical case, but very important, day in and day out, you would be seeing these type of cases, especially postpartum lady complaining of headache, vomiting and seizures. So always we do a T2 weighted imaging and then you have flare and diffusion weighted. You are seeing bilateral thalamus and the basal ganglia hyperintensities, including the flare, you are seeing similar hyperintensity, and a diffusion weighted is a restricted diffusion. And further imaging shows the ADC is showing a low value in the great cerebral wing. Once you are seeing a low value in the great cerebral wing, you need to do an MR venogram. So this case in MR venogram showed there is hypointensity in the great cerebral wing and the straight side. It's a classical case of a venous infarct. So make it a point, usually whenever I suspect a venous infarct, usually they would send for a CT. And you are suspecting an abnormality, definitely take the patient to MR. This is the standard sequence where you need to do a T2 flare and diffusion. And when you're seeing in ADC a low signal, always do a MR venogram to rule out any thrombosis in the cerebral veins. Okay. Come to case number 3, 38-year-old male, a history of partial hanging, drowsy and semi-conscious. The moment you see the history, there is a history of partial hanging, semi-conscious. Obviously, you need to think of HI hypoxia. So when you think of hypoxia, what are the things you're supposed to evaluate in the brain? Like what are sequences? You're sitting in front of consult. Okay, hypoxia, the patient is giving history. So what are the sequences? As I told you, always never forget to do a flare coronal image. So in MR, you're seeing there are bilateral thalamic and the basal ganglia and the flare hyperintensities. And diffusion weighted string class restriction. And also in some few areas in the parietal lobe, you can see the diffusion restriction. So an ADC map shows a low signal state consistent with the cytotoxic edema. So day in day out, you'll be seeing plenty of cases like hypoxia, even the carbon monoxide poisoning. So many classical cases of hypoxia, newborn with hypoxia. So these are mandatory sequences which you are supposed to do. Take a correct history and then evaluate the images. Don't directly start seeing the images and start reporting. Talk to the patient, evaluate, and then do the reporting. Fine. So case number 4, 70-year-old male, complaints of involuntary movements involving both the upper limbs. So they're given a history on examination. A KF instance in the cornea, that's increased serum and urine copper. I don't know how many residents will see the cornea or any patient. So most of the time they would have documented in the case sheet or in the history that are written, ophthalmic reference are written. So make it a point to always check the history, what is there. So when they're seeing involuntary movements of both upper and lower limbs for 17-year young male, so always try to look to increased copper levels in serum and the urine. And then try to look if there are any abnormalities in the cornea. Hardly we go out and talk to the patient, but make it a point you talk to the patient and see and take yourself history rather than being dependent on the clinician's history. So what you are seeing is a hypointensity, T1 and T2, you are seeing a flare hyperintensity in the bilateral basal ganglia as well as the thalamus. The flare imaging you are seeing hyperintensity. And it is most commonly involving the ventrolateral aspect, ventrolateral nuclei, the bilateral thalamus. So next, you are seeing the famous signs to see. Many of the conditions, they say the face of giant panda or a double panda sign, they say. So they're classically seen at the midbrain level, where the mesencephalic substantia angular and the red nuclei show hypointensity. This is a red nuclei showing hypointensity towards the surrounding white matter. So this is a classical case of Wilson's disease. Please read about Wilson's disease. Very important. You will always have this case in any of the examiner's collection as a short case or a long case. You will have a Wilson's disease. Important is to identify the KF in history on examination of cornea. The other important findings will be that will be T1 hypointensity, flare hyperintensity, and the T2 hyperintensity will be seen in the basal ganglia and the thalamus. Okay. Case 5, for a 26-year-old primary, for complaints of excess vomiting and complaints of altered behavior like talking to self and difficulty in using both the lower limbs. So MR imaging was done. Again, you can see a T2 flare and hyperintensity in the bilateral thalamus and the caudate nuclei. So most commonly in this condition, what has happened? The thalamus is involved most commonly in the middle thalamus, the sparing of the lateral. So middle thalamus is involved. So you should have some differentials. There are one or two disease hardly, which will predominantly affect only the medial thalamus. So diffusion weighted showed restricted diffusion. So this was a case of Wernicke encephalopathy. Case number 6, 40-year-old male, complaints of type 2 diabetes mellitus, history of fall and aphasia, and a lab musical showed a decreased serum sodium level. So quite very important, when there is a decreased sodium level, you need to always check the aspect of osmotic demyelination syndrome. So we hardly check the sodium level, sometimes the electrolyte imbalance, the complaints of diabetic patient. Most common diabetic, you need to always check the serum sodium. So in MR imaging, you're seeing a hypointensity and the basal ganglia thalamus in the central pons. And the corresponding image in T2 weighted, you are seeing hyperintensity is in the basal ganglia as well as the thalamus and the central pons. So the further image in coronal T2 flare, you are seeing the hyperintensities. So the central pons, it is mainly involved in the central pons with the sparing of the periphery. So this was a classical case of osmotic demyelination syndrome. Okay. Case number 7, a 10-year-old boy presented with choroid movements from 3 months. So MR imaging was done. So see the MR imaging, that in the bilateral thalamus, predominant the thalamus is hypointense on T1, corresponding on T2, it is hyperintense, and clear it is hyperintense, but it shows diffuse enlargement. You see a thalamic such diffuse enlargement, hyperintense on T2 and hyperintense on flare, need to always suspect some malignancy, because in the previous case of whatever is the infective etiology or a thrombus or whatever, there will not be any diffuse enlargement of the thalamus or the basal ganglia, but here you are seeing diffuse enlargement of the thalamus. So there is a mass effect in the form of which is causing hydrocephalus. So on the ADC it shows increased signal and there is no diffusion restriction. So spectroscopic showed the increased choline peaks and a decreased NA and PR. So this was a classical case of a glioma. So very important, glioma, day in day out you see plenty of cases in India. You should have a very good knowledge about glioma, the imaging, spectroscopic findings, diffusion, what is the further management, but how is that patient is being treated, and recently the patterns have been changed. So in exam also they do ask about one line of treatment which you need to know, whether you treat or not, whether it's a medical line of management or it's a surgical line of management. One line about the treatment aspect, including intervention of all the above conditions which we discussed just now about these commonest conditions which you see, which you have to know. So I'll just come to DDs. There are many conditions. I've just put few representative images. If at all we are suspecting infection which is affecting bilateral basal ganglia and thalamic, where the infective etiology, they give history of fever and the history of loss of consciousness, altered sensorium, young age or whatever, based on the history. So infections, always think of Japanese encephalitis. We have come up with vaccines now for Japanese encephalitis, not much commonly seen. So again, you have hyperintensities in the thalamus and the basal ganglia. Cerebral malaria, so classical case of cerebral malaria, where again hyperintensity on flare in bilateral thalamus. So malaria, it definitely it has been diagnosed by the blood, look for the parasite. So you need to correlate the blood, whatever investigations with your MR imaging findings. Then you have a Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, it's a classical case involving bilateral hyperintensities in the basal ganglia and the thalamus. So Creutzfeldt and Jakob are two different neurologists from Germany. Sometimes please read about these names. Just don't tell Creutzfeldt and Jakob. So those are two different neurologists from Germany who discovered and coined this hyperintense in the basal ganglia and thalamus. So then coming to toxoplasmosis, you have severe paralysis, edema. Also involves sometimes the basal ganglia and the thalamus. You always have a history in a compromised patient or a HIV patient or with large paralysis edema. You can further evaluate with spectroscopy. So the classical case of toxoplasmosis. Then cryptoporphyrosis, not routinely you see, mainly you see cryptoporphyrosis among the immunocompromised patient. It commonly affects the basal ganglia and the thalamus. Coming to vascular, what we did is you want to suspect if the patient is complaining of vomiting, loss of vision, headache, other complications. You always think of some arterial thrombosis of the artery supplying the thalamus, that is mainly the posterior circulation. And if the basal ganglia is the middle cerebral artery, you need to evaluate them in MR angiogram. If you're suspecting venous, I told you, if it is a hypo-intensity on a GRE imaging or a MR venogram, you need to look for this any filling defect or whatever. They always suspect a venous involved. So HIE, you know, there's a case of like poisoning or like carbon monoxide poisoning or a partial hanging with a hypoxia. So it will commonly affect the bilateral basal ganglia and the thalamus. So history plays a very important role in coming to a differential when you are drafting the report. And again, in the postpartum, posterior visible encephalopathy syndrome, it commonly affects the bilateral occipital parietal lobes, including the thalamus. Okay. Coming to metabolic, there's 5 to 6 conditions. Wilson's disease, I told you, the pandas and the giant pandas and mainly copper metabolism. Leakes disease is mainly mitochondrial disorder, very commonly seen less than 2 years age group. So you need to check for the bilateral basal ganglia hyperintensities and thalamic hyperintensities. Fast disease, again associated with calcium metabolism, is increased deposition of calcium. Please read about calcium metabolism and vitamin D. Every exam's favorite question these days, what is briefly tell about the calcium metabolism. So when you read about calcium metabolism, please read about hypo and hyperparathyroidism, pseudo hyperparathyroidism and pseudo. They are very favorite questions. What is pseudo, what is hypo and hypo, they keep asking. So in hyper, in fast, you are seeing like hyperintensity in the basal ganglia because of the calcium deposition. In Fabry's disease, so it's a lysosomal storage disease. Usually, you see a T1 hyperintensity along with the hyperintensity in the T2 weighted in the thalamus. And then you have Wernicke's and osmodemolition syndrome. I've already discussed about Wernicke's and osmodemolition. You expect a sodium imbalance. Wernicke's we already discussed. Right? So, next coming to neoplasm, I've not gone into much detail, I've just shown only one representative case of glioma. which commonly affects the bilateral thalamus with enlargement of the thalamus. You're seeing, always think of a malignancy with a relative of hydrocephalus. Fine. So with the conclude, bilateral basal ganglion calcification, a variety of causes, most important, very important, always ask a history and evaluate by yourself rather than seeing the clinician's history note. You talk to the patient attenders, and try to elicit the history from how many days the symptoms, is the patient already previously, what are the other associated ocular disturbance, whatever the associate, please do ask. Laboratory plays a very important role, as I told you, especially for Wilson's disease, for serum copper, like you're suspecting osmodination, serum sodium, everything. So it plays a very important role, laboratory investigations, and the knowledge of associated MR findings. At all, you need to know, like, typically which disease will affect bilateral basal ganglia and the thalamus, which disease will affect only the medial aspect of the thalamus, which disease will affect only the lateral aspect of the thalamus. So when you have a sound knowledge of the MR imaging findings, you can correlate with laboratory investigations and the clinical history and make it very easy when you're drafting the report. So narrow down the differentials and give specific diagnosis in certain clinical conditions. So I would like to end this with this. I would highlight this article. I want every one of you to go to radiographics and read about the article named Differential Diagnosis for Bilateral Abnormalities of the Basal Ganglia and the Thalamus.